How to make a change with food. My name is Joszi Smeets and I'm the director of the youth food movement in the Netherlands. So in 20 minutes time, I will try to make you aware of the central role that food plays in our lives. I will also tell you about the youth food movement, what we do, and how we create change in Europe and beyond. Food is central to the way our society works, and in my opinion, food is one of the most simple ways to address the complexities, ecological and social complexities of these times. But to start off with, food is something that is really close to our heart. Food is embedded in our culture, in our rituals, and in our minds, our memories, and in our relationships with our loved ones and our family. I want to start off with one of my favorite movies, Ratatouille. And in this scene, I think they can really show that they really did a good job in showing how close to our heart food can really be.
Look, Colette, wait! Colette, you came back. Colette, I...
Don't say a word. If I think about it, I might change my mind. Just tell me what the rat wants to cook. Ratatouille? It's a peasant dish. Are you sure you want to serve this to Eagle? What? I am making ratatouille. Well, how would you prepare it?
They must be joking.
Who cooks the ratatouille? I demand to know!
So food is really close to our hearts. And at the same time, it's one of the most complex issues of our time. It's about ecological and social problems. And if you look a little bit further, you will see that food is central to the way our society works. Let's go back in time to explain that. 10,000 years ago, the rise of cities and the rise of agriculture happened at the same time, and that's no coincidence. Cities asked for people who wanted to work, but they didn't really have time and they didn't really have place to produce their own food anymore. So they asked more and more food of the farmers, and that meant that farmers had to grow their land and grow their produces. So still, food was very central in our cities. Most cities are built at waterfronts so that food and all the spices and the other products around it could be imported in the city, And there were also streets built just for the import of food. And there were squares built just for the trade of food. One of the most common ones is the meat district in London. It's called meat district for a reason. And if you bike through your city, that's a very Dutch thing to do, but also if you walk through your city, you will see a lot of street names with food names in it. Food was all around us in that time, so the smells, but also the sounds of the cattle, and also the way it was slaughtered, for example. So you couldn't really ignore how food was produced. It was all around us. Nowadays, that's completely different. When you look at cities at this moment, if I look outside now, I only see bricks, some trees, and lots of cars and buildings. Food isn't visible anymore for us, and the way food is produced isn't visible. Even more, I tend to believe that we are living in a society of boxes. We live in a box, we go to our box on four wheels, and we drive to another box that sells food in boxes. And we bring these boxes home, and then we put these boxes in another box called our microwave. And after, we eat our food in front of a box called television. So where our food is coming from isn't visible anymore. And we think it's really normal to live in places where food has no key role in what we see when we walk through our streets. But cities need a lot of food. And you have to think that the food that we eat every day, 3 or 5 times a day, is produced somewhere. And not only produced, but also packaged, transported, sometimes pre-cooked, and then served in restaurants, in takeaways, where more and more people get their food. So it's not that simple as eating an apple. That apple comes from a place, and the seeds of that apple comes from a place, and the seeds go in the soil, and the soil is also the way it is because of the way of agriculture that is on our soil. So there's a whole world behind our food, and I think more and more people don't realize that anymore. So when you hear me saying you are what you eat, what does that mean? I want you to think about it, and I also want you to think about the fact that when we don't know where our food is coming from, do we know what we eat, or does it have to be spelled for us?
How do you create dishes like rotation risotto that become important to someone to repeat? Well, that's it. What if you had, like all cuisines, 200 of those kinds of dishes? And what if people started requesting them over and over again? Does it become a cuisine in my lifetime? I don't know, but as Wes Jackson likes to say, if you're thinking about an idea that you can solve in your lifetime, you're thinking too small. That gives me great hope and also great energy. Because I don't know where else all of these ideas come together. If you're a nutritionist, you're looking at this from a very myopic view. It's an important one, but it's myopic. If you're an agricultural economist, you have a different view of it. If you're an ecologist, you're preserving the open space, you have another view of it. Where is the connection? Plate of food. Plate of food. And that's the power of the chef.
No, definitely not. But I think what Dan Barber, you just heard Dan Barber, he's a chef in San Francisco, and he's also a part of Slow Food, and he's the writer of the book The Third Plate. What Dan Barber is trying to say, that food is an interdisciplinary act, and to really understand the issues behind a plate of food, you have to look at it in a multidisciplinary way. And that means that if you want to solve those issues, you also have to come up with interdisciplinary solutions. No, definitely not. I wish it was easy. And especially for us young people, I mean, we don't have a lot of experience. We are not as wise yet as the people who are older than we are. So there are most and foremost a lot of questions that we have. So the youth food movement organizes all kinds of events to create awareness for young people. The other thing is that we organize a youth food movement academy every year. So every year we select 25 young, talented people from all over the food chain. So fishermen, farmers, but also people who work in banks, people who work as a food designer, people who work in a restaurant as a chef, or maybe a nutritionist or a doctor. All these people have, in some way, a connection to food, but their point of views are completely different and they normally don't meet each other. So we arrange a 6-month year program in which we travel with this group of young people through the food system to show them all kinds of places that our food is traveling through, also to provide them with masterclasses from food experts, and to let them think together and work together on dilemmas in our food system, and to let them come up with interdisciplinary solutions for these dilemmas. Well, changing the food system is certainly not an easy thing to do. It doesn't start at one point in time. It doesn't start at one point in the chain, and if you think you have a solution, the solution is not a one-size-fits-all solution. So you're talking about a global system, and that global system has different food systems inside, and all these systems are existing of all kinds of different actors, all kinds of different individuals working as actors, with all kinds of different emotions and opinions. So it is not a clear cut. That is for sure. There are no black and white rules. And I will give you there are many examples of this, but two examples that strike me most. One of them is about a friend of mine that I met at the youth food movement. His name is Bas. He's a pig farmer. And he just switched to organic 1 or 2 years ago. Before, he used to feed his pigs the waste of his neighbor who was producing sugarcane. So the waste of the land was given to Bas, his animals, as food. But now, because he's organic and his neighbor is not, Bas cannot do this anymore, so it's not a closed cycle anymore. Bas has to import food, for example soya, from far away, Brazil. So the thing that he's importing is organic now. But what is more sustainable? Is that the first example or the last example? So again, it's not really black and white. Organic is not the solution to everything, because sometimes it also means long distance travel of cattle feed. Another dilemma that I actually discovered the last year was the dilemma of the side effects of us drinking milk and eating meat. Because what lots of us don't know is that for every milk cow, there's a bull that is born. And for every chicken that makes eggs, is a rooster that is born. And these animals aren't really easy for consumption, so we just don't use them and they get to waste, or they are not valuable anymore and get exported. So there's no value for male animals. And you can be a vegetarian, but if you eat goat cheese, you also produce male goats. And what happens with these male goats? Because they cannot produce milk for your goat cheese. So you're still part of the production of meat and of the production of invaluable animals. There are many more dilemmas that I could talk about. I could talk about the major challenge in feeding the growing world population, and if we have not enough food, or if it is a distribution problem. I can talk about sugar that's in almost every product and the way that we are almost addicted to sugar. I can talk about the superfoods trend and how our quest for quinoa is not very positive for farmers from Peru, who don't have enough quinoa anymore to feed themselves. I can talk about biodiversity and even more about the loss of it. I can talk about the different diets and how education is also affecting what children want to eat. I can talk about the way food is distributed and how we eat products that are not coming from our own lands. I can talk about how power is distributed in the food chain and how a few companies own almost all the other companies. I can also talk about the risks leading to how our political money is distributed. So as you can see, many of the risks to death in perspective are related to food, like high blood pressure, high cholesterol, and things like war or murder are a lower risk for us. Still, we spend much more money on war than on good food education. But I'm not going to do that, because there are too many dilemmas and I now want to talk about solutions. And therefore, I want to explain a little bit more about what we do. I think that not only we are a solution, but the whole global network that we are a part of. We are not only in the Netherlands, we are based all over the world. So here you see a picture of one of our international meetings, where I was with young people from Brazil, India, Uganda, Korea, France. Everywhere there are people in their own communities, in their own cultures, building solutions. And that is the main thing about a grassroots movement. We don't believe in one size fits all. We think that people in their own communities are the experts of the solutions that can help over there. For example, in Uganda, they are more working on community gardens, whereas here we are organizing a food film festival. Two different solutions on two different food systems with different cultures and different habits. So there's a lot of freedom to do whatever you want to do in your own community, as long as it is based on the mission of Slow Food, and that is good, clean and fair food accessible for everyone. Good means high quality food, flavorsome and healthy food. Clean means that it didn't harm the environment, and fair means that it is accessible for a fair price and that the producers also receive a fair price. For the youth food movement, we believe that by connecting people from all over the food chain, from different disciplines, that we are making a change. Here's a model of the transition theory. It looks really complicated, but basically what it means is that if there is a landscape development that is already pointing out that things are changing in the food system, that it doesn't work anymore, and that people are getting more and more interested, and we think that that is what's happening right now, and if the regime, the social technical regime that decides where markets are focusing on, where science, policy, culture and technology is focusing on, is already showing signs of transition. Things are not working anymore. People want different solutions. And if in the technological niches there are people, individuals, with local, small alternatives, that these local, small alternatives can grow out to be a bigger thing. And because that landscape development is already going on, they can become the new regime. And we believe that by educating youngsters and also by connecting with youngsters who are now working in the regime but want to make a change, we can hack the system and build a new food system. I believe that Europe is on the edge of change, and I believe that it is about time. Change is not coming from politicians anymore. Change is coming from ourselves. We are the owners of change. That's what you see when you look at our movement. It's a grassroots movement. People don't go to the main square in their city to protest and wait for politicians to change things. No, we do it ourselves. We go and start and build projects, communities, new initiatives. We don't yell to the industry. No, we see if we can make a coalition. And because industry wants to change as well, since they want to be sustainable and, well, still exist in the future, they have to coalesce. Also with food activists. We get invited to talk to the boards of the biggest companies in Holland, even from Europe or the world. We also get invited by the parliament in Brussels to talk about our projects, to inspire. They take us very seriously. And that gives me proof that what we are doing is really making a change. So in terms of ownership, in terms of how to make change, I think you can see our movement as a new perspective, a new initiative that is showing that we are on the edge of change. We are talking about food, but this is the same in all other sectors. We want to make a change of food, and I hope that you are going to change a thing in your passion.